Welcome again to 100% Reformados. My name is Andres Martinez and I'm from Puerto Rico. In this video, we're going to be talking about the deity of Christ in the Gospel of Mark again, as we did in our last video. And we're going to be specifically focusing on Mark chapter 2. Recently, I found a video from this guy, I think his name is Kel Smith. He hosts the Trinity Delusion YouTube channel. And he recently posted a video on Mark chapter 2. If you have seen my last video, you know that I did too. And of course, I claimed that in this passage, Mark chapter 2, Jesus is clearly claiming to be God in this passage. And so, Kel, in his video, is trying to refute the Trinitarian understanding of this text. What I'm going to do in this video is that I'm going to refute his interpretation and refute his claims about this passage. Let's read Mark chapter 2, verses 1 through 12 from the ESV. It says, "And when he returned to Capernaum, after some days it was reported that he was at home, and many were gathered together so that there was no more room, not even at the door. And he was preaching the word to them, and they came, bringing to him a paralytic carried by four men. And when they could not get near him because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him. And when they had made an opening, they let down the bed on which the paralytic lay. And when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, 'Son, your sins are forgiven.' Now some of the scribes were sitting there, questioning in their hearts, 'Why does this man speak like that? He is blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone?' And immediately Jesus, perceiving in his spirit that they thus questioned within themselves, said to them, 'Why do you question these things in your hearts? Which is easier, to say to the paralytic, your sins are forgiven, or to say, rise, take up your bed, and walk? But that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins,' he said to the paralytic, 'I say to you, rise, pick up your bed, and go home.' And he rose and immediately picked up his bed and went out before them all, so that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, 'We never saw anything like this.'" Now, Kel's argument starts trying to phrase the Trinitarian claim or the Trinitarian argument. He says that we Trinitarians say that the Pharisees, the scribes, said that only God could forgive sins. Jesus forgave the sins of the paralytic, therefore Jesus is God. Well, that's not wrong, that is our claim, but Kel misses some key aspects that we would add to that claim in order to actually prove that in this text Jesus is indeed claiming to be God. And that he misses a lot of things. And so what he says about our claim is that it implies that we agree with the scribes or Pharisees. And from his perspective, what Jesus was doing is that he was proving the Pharisees to be wrong and that God was the only one that could forgive sins. From his perspective, God is not the only one that can forgive sins because God gave authority to Jesus to forgive sins. And since from his perspective, Jesus was proving this to the Pharisees or the scribes, Jesus was proving that they were wrong in saying that God was the only one that could do this because he had this authority as well, then if Jesus was proving them wrong and we agree with the Pharisees, then Jesus was proving us Trinitarians wrong. That is what he says in his video. And he says, his interpretation, what he says about the text, the main argument, is that the very point of the account is that Jesus was proving them to be wrong in that regard, and that God was not the only one that could forgive sins. He says that is the very point of the account. Now, as I'm going to show you, I believe that the fundamental error with Kel's interpretation is that the main concern of the scribes here was not that God was the only one that could forgive sins. It's what that Jesus is, it was that they thought Jesus was blaspheming. And they had reasons to think that, to believe that. Let's take a look. Let's begin in verse 5. Verse 5 says, "And when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, 'Son, your sins are forgiven.'" So he claimed to have forgiven the sins of the paralytic. And verse 6 says, "Now some of the scribes were sitting there, questioning in their hearts, 'Listen to the what the scribes were questioning in their hearts. Listen to this. Why does this man speak like that? He is blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone? Now look at this verse. We have two questions and a statement. Which of those do you think that was the main concern or the actual statement of what the Pharisees were thinking? If we look at the verse, there are two questions and one statement. What is that statement? It is, he is blaspheming. In the Greek text, that's just one verb. It is a verb, and it is in the indicative mode that tells us that that is the main assertion of the Pharisees. So their main concern is not, this guy is only a man. It's not, God is the only one that can forgive sins. It is, Jesus is blaspheming. Now, the reasons why they believe that he is blaspheming are given in the two rhetorical questions that they ask. What are those questions? They are, why does this man speak like that? And the other, who can forgive sins but God alone? Those are the reasons of the main assertion, that is, he is blaspheming. So notice the first question, notice what it says. Why does this man speak like that? They believed that Jesus was only a man. They believed that Jesus was a mere man. And the other question, who can forgive sins but God alone? So what they were thinking was that this guy is a blasphemer. He is blaspheming. Why is he blaspheming? Because he is a man. And as a man, he is claiming to do something that only God can do. So that is why he is blaspheming, and that was their main concern. Now that we know what was their main concern, now let's look at what Jesus did. Verse 8 says, and immediately Jesus, perceiving in his spirit that they thus questioned within themselves, so Jesus knew what they were thinking in his spirit. And keep that in mind, not just because I can prove to you with this that Jesus was omniscient. Not just by that, but keep that in mind, because that is key for you to be able to put yourself in the place of the Pharisees and ask yourself, when Jesus healed the paralytic, what would the scribes or the Pharisees would have understood with what he did and what he said? So keep that in mind. This verse 8, says, and immediately Jesus, perceiving in his spirit that they thus questioned within themselves, said to them, why do you question these things in your hearts? What things? Jesus already knew what they were thinking. What were they thinking? They were thinking that Jesus was blaspheming because as a man, he was claiming to do something that only God could do. And he asked them, why do you question these things in your hearts? Which is easier, to say to the paralytic, your sins are forgiven, or to say, rise, take up your bed, and walk? But that you may know, and obviously we know that this question of Jesus is a rhetorical question. We all know what is the harder thing. Verse 10 says, but that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, he said to the paralytic, I say to you, rise, pick up your bed, and go home. Now, part of the misinterpretation of Kel lies in the fact that he totally misunderstands Jesus' usage of the Son of Man. Yes, it is a way to say that we are human beings. If I say I am the Son of Man, I'm saying that I am a human being. But what does Jesus mean when he says I am the Son of Man? Definite article. Of course, Cal, if you're watching this video, you know what we're going to say. And every Unitarian that is watching this video knows what we Trinitarians will say. Jesus is referring to Daniel chapter 7. And what happens in Daniel chapter 7? The Son of Man is given worship. The original word in Daniel 7:14 for the verb to serve is the word palach. I'm not sure if it is Hebrew or Aramaic, but the point is, it is the word palach. When Daniel chapter 7:14 says that all the nations and peoples should serve him, The word for serve is palach, and this word in the book of Daniel, it is always used to denote worship being given either to the true gods by the Jews or false gods by the pagans. So Daniel saw this Son of Man, and Jesus is claiming to be the Son of Man, that Son of Man who, according to Daniel chapter 7, would receive worship. And if we understand what Jesus means when he says, so that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, if we understand correctly what he's saying there, then it is absolutely clear that he is refuting what the Jews actually thought. What did they think? What did they thought? What was their main concern? Jesus is a blasphemer because he's a man and he's claiming to do something that only God can do. But what would be the ultimate proof for Jesus? What would be the best way to prove them wrong in that regard, in the actual regard of the text? It would be to prove to them, dudes, I am God. I am the Son of Man who received worship in Daniel chapter 7. So I have the authority to forgive sins as God has. And yes, God is the only one that can forgive sins. That is why the scribes thought this, because this is exactly what the Old Testament teaches. Look at, for example, Isaiah chapter 43, verse 25. It says, I am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake, and I will not remember your sins. And we can look also to Micah chapter 7, verse 18, actually verses 18 through 20. It says, who is a God like you, pardoning iniquity and passing over transgression for the remnant of his inheritance? He does not retain his anger forever because he delights in steadfast love. He will again have compassion on us. He will tread our iniquities underfoot. You will cast out our sins into the depths of the sea. You will show faithfulness to Jacob and steadfast love to Abraham, as you have sworn to our fathers from the days of old. So the Old Testament teaches that God is the only one that can forgive sins, and that is why the Pharisees thought that. And Jesus didn't deny that. Jesus did not deny the very teaching of the Old Testament. He denied what they were actually thinking. They were thinking that he was a blasphemer, and that was what he was denying. That was what he was refuting with what he did. And how did he prove to them that he was not a blasphemer? Because he said to them, which is easier, to say to the paralytic, your sins are forgiven, or to say, rise, take up your bed and walk? But that you may know that the Son of Man, referring to Daniel chapter 7, has authority on earth to forgive sins, he said to the paralytic, I say to you, rise, pick up your bed and go home. So he did the harder thing, what he called the harder thing, as Kael himself says, by doing the harder thing, he proved that by default, he could do the easier thing. And actually, it's not harder in the sense that for Jesus, it was harder by nature to heal someone and easier to forgive the sins of someone. Because from our perspective, Trinitarians, we believe that Jesus can do either of those things easily. From Kel's perspective, I believe that both authorities to forgive sins and to heal a paralytic are both given to Jesus by God. So how one of those authorities given by God to Jesus could be harder than the other? What Jesus means when he says easier and harder, it's not easier and harder in and of itself, and in and of itself, it's nature. What he's saying is, which of these is more incredible for you? To say to the paralytic, your sins are forgiven? Of course not, because you cannot see that. You cannot see sins being forgiven. Obviously, for you, it is more incredible that I should heal this paralytic, because you can't see that. And then you guys will get amazed. That is exactly what happened in verse 12. They got amazed. So Jesus, with the harder thing, with the more incredible thing, prove to them that he could do the easier thing, that which they could not see with their own eyes. So he proved to them by healing the paralytic and by referring to himself as the Son of Man who received worship in Daniel chapter 7, He proved to the Pharisees, I am not a blasphemer because I am God. I am the Son of Man that received worship in Daniel chapter 7. And I have this authority to forgive sins and to do something harder or more incredible, that is, to heal this guy. Now, Kel appeals to the parallel account on the book of Matthew, Matthew chapter 9, and he specifically uses verse 8. Matthew 9:8 says, when the crowd saw it, they were afraid, and they glorified God who had given such authority to men. And what Kel actually tries to argue with this text, is that the people understood that Jesus was claiming to be a man to whom God had given this authority. Now, the crowds may have understood that, but what did the Pharisees actually understood? And now, remember that I told you to keep that thing in mind about Jesus knowing what the Pharisees were thinking? Put yourself in that position. You are a Bible-believing Jew. You believe that only God can forgive sins. And this guy says, I am forgiving the sins of this paralytic. And you say, you're a blasphemer. You cannot do that. You're just a man. And this guy suddenly knows what you're thinking without you telling him. And he says, why are you questioning me? Why are you questioning what I'm doing in your heart? Which is easier. And then he goes on and does something really incredible. And he refers to himself as the Son of Man who received worship in Daniel chapter 7. You, as that Pharisee, what would you have understood? Would you have understood that Jesus was a mere man to whom God had given authority to forgive sins? Of course not. You would have understood that Jesus was claiming to have, by nature, the same authority that God had to forgive sins. And so, I believe that with this I have demonstrated the misuse and the misunderstanding and misinterpretation of Cal Smith, or the Trinity Delusion. I believe that this is a good refutation of his arguments. You can go check his video out. I'm going to put the link in the description below so you can check it out. So, Cal, I'm going to be praying for you if you get to watch this video. And I would gladly respond to any comments or any videos when I have the opportunity. May God bless you all and keep searching the scriptures.